Hey, what's going on, guys? In this video, we're going to talk about when I sold the Les Spare. Headache. I found this image right here of my old Les Spare Ultimate Tactical Carry and the Colt Special Combat Government. Both of these I sold privately, and they were both good sales. The Colt went fine, no problems there. The Les Spare I thought went fine, but it gave me a headache about a month ago. So I figured I'd just do this video to share with you my experience, you know, entertainment value, what have you. Maybe you'll get something out of it, or you guys can let me know what you think about all this. Now, I did a video about selling guns privately and all the weirdness and headaches that come with that. A lot of people I remember when I did that video were saying, like, well, that didn't happen to me. You know, after I do a sale with someone privately, it's fine. It's okay. And normally that is the case, but I don't know, in recent times, earlier in 2016, I did do a lot of selling, you know, just to liquidate some stuff and put that towards investments as well as in a gun fund. I just kind of dealt with just weird people. I don't know how to put it. I don't want to say weird, but people that just want to get a deal. So they lowball, so a lot of lowballing. And then when you agree upon a price, they disappear. So they're not serious. So it's a lot of time and energy that's wasted. So, but anyways, most of the times, that's it. You just walk away from it. No big deal. You know, wasted some time and energy. Just move on to the next person that wants to buy it. Now, with the Les Spare, I actually had two different guys that really wanted it. One guy, you know, I had a price out for it, and the guy actually offered me $100 more, and I was like, whoa. All right, and when I told it to the other guy that wanted it, he offered me $200 more, which brought it to a break even. So I was like, what? So business is business. I went back to the other buyer and explained to him, hey, I got another buyer that's going to pay this much. And he said, oh, I'm going to walk away. You know, that's okay. No big deal. And I said, all right, yeah, no big deal. So I went back to the other buyer and said, all right, let's do this transaction up. I'm set, ready to go if you are. And he's like, yeah, I am. Oh, I can't wait to get this Les Spare. Oh, this is awesome. Thank you. Oh, yeah. And he was exhibiting some impulsive behavior. And that made me a little wary, a little nervous. Just because in my experience, guys, you know, in private sales, guys that acted like that really didn't mean what they say. And they had no intentions of buying anything. So I was a little, even if you go to a gun shop and you just observe the customers, you know, everyone's like looking at guns and fondling them. Of course they want it, of course. And they're exhibiting that same behavior, like, oh, I want this, oh, this is going to be awesome. But they don't end up walking out of the store with it, or not that day at least. So I was kind of like, I don't know if this guy's serious. Just because, and he was acting immature, which was a little weird to me. But he says, let's meet up at a gun shop in the parking lot and do the transaction and transfer. So I said, okay, but first I need you to email me a copy of your pistol permanent driver's license, please. You know, because I wanted to get that first. And he did. So I was looking over his information, you know, do a little Google here and there. The guy was a professional. You know, he worked for a very large corporation. I was like, okay, guy's legit and, you know, he's serious, obviously. So we made arrangements to meet up at this gun store that's about 50 minutes away from me. You know, it's kind of far. And I show up on the day where, you know, we agreed upon. And I waited around for 1 hour. And he doesn't show up. I was texting, calling, no response. So I was like, you know what? That's okay. I knew the guy wasn't serious. So, you know, I browsed this gun shop for a little bit. And then I went on my merry way. The following day, he calls me and says, oh, I'm sorry I didn't make it. I was trying to get my funds together. I just couldn't get the money together. But you know what? If we could wait till next week, I'll have the funds all together. I'll get a bank check and everything. So I said, all right, fine. So we decided to meet up at a mall, at a parking lot, which again was not close to me. It was, yeah, like 50 minutes almost. And this time when I showed up, he was there early. So I was like, all right, oh, here he is. I'm like, okay, he's serious. And we get there, hands me over the bank check, and actually that bank was across the street, so I was going to go there right away to make sure everything was okay, but obviously it was. But he was looking over the Les Spare, and his behavior was just really weird. Like, he was, like, caressing it. He kissed it. I was like, while I was doing the calling in for a sales authorization number and writing up the paperwork, he was like, oh, I can't wait, man. I can't wait to get this thing to the range. I'm going to go to my gun club tonight and shoot it. Oh, you know what? I think I might want to carry this. Yeah, I think I'm going to carry it. Oh, I don't know. What kind of ammunition do you think? I was like, whoa, whoa, relax. He was asking me so many questions while I was on the phone and trying to write the paperwork, and very distracting. You know, I was trying to get, you got to be very exact with the paperwork. You don't want to mess things up, you know? it's not like you're selling a used iPhone or something like that. You know, it's a firearm. So the behavior was just really weird. He was very immature. He was in his mid-30s and everything. So I was like, it's just weird. But hey, business is business. So we completed everything, you know, the bill of sale that I created. We signed a couple copies, hard copies. We signed it on each hard copy. You know, he got his copies. I did the authorization, like I said, with the paperwork. He took his piece. I took all my paperwork. Then I got to send that out to all the different agencies, you know, where he resides, the state and what have you. And we went on our merry way. I went to the bank. Everything was fine. Cashed it. So that was that. And that was back in June. I think it was June 2016. So, now fast forward to about last month. Yeah, I get a text out of the blue from an unknown saying, hey, we need to talk. I'd like to get the money back. I was like, oh, this is the wrong number. So I just delete it. A couple days later, hey, what's up? I need the money back. Give me a call immediately. I delete it. I don't know what this number is. Finally, I get a phone call the following week from a private number, and I don't know, so I don't answer it. But the person leaves a voice message, so I listen to it. It's the guy that bought the Les Bear. In a nutshell, he just said, hey, I need to get my money back. Please call me as soon as possible. You know, this is very important. I need to get that money back. Really? So, as a courtesy, I was like, you know what? I'm just going to call the guy back. So, when I called him back, he was demanding his money back. He's like, dude, you got to give me my money back. All right, we'll meet up. We're going to do a transfer, okay? You're going to take the Les Bear back, and then you're going to pay me what I paid you, because all I was doing was really holding it, right? I was like, excuse me? Now, I would like to refer you to your bill of sale. He's like, what does that mean? I don't understand. Huh? What was that? Like, he's acting like an idiot now. So, like, sir, refer to the bill of sale that you and I signed, you know, all sales. What? No, I think you're making this up right now. We didn't sign anything. I don't have a copy. Well, I do with your signature. No, you must have forged it or something. So I basically said, well, sir, I'm going to disconnect the call right now. There's nothing more to discuss. Thank you very much. I hung up on him. Well, I was a little like, oh, great. Why didn't I just put it on consignment? You know, at a gun shop, let them handle this, you know, because actually gun shops do handle a lot of weird stuff with customers, and I tell you, anyways, the guy did call me back and left a message. I didn't respond to him. Finally, he called another time, so I said, all right, I'll call him one more time. And he was very, very reasonable, down to earth. And basically, what he told me was, you know, hey, business is business, it's your life, it's not my problem. Bye bye. But apparently, what happened was his wife found out that he bought this Les Bear with, I guess, cash that came out of, you know, whatever account, and, well, she's pissed. They have a 5-year-old daughter. He's like, oh, I can't feed her. I mean, he could be just giving me a line. It's because of this Les Bear. Well, sorry, it's not my problem. You know, oh, how can you, you're not human. Again, it's not my problem. You know, business is business. So I guess it just boils down to the other half found out about it and got pissed. And wanted to get the money back. So, I guess what ended up happening was, just recently, a friend of mine was at Cabela's and said, I think I saw that Les Bear you used to own, you know, that you sold in the used gun case, in the gun library. I was like, really? He's like, yeah, it's there. I think it's yours. So, I was able to verify it was the one I had owned previously, and I guess he sold it to Cabela's. So there you go, guys. When I sold the Les Bear, guess entertainment or something interesting to think about. I just wanted to share that experience with you. All right, guys, that's it. So as always, stay safe and check 360 often. Later.